This is Ham Radio Now, episode 259, PokéHAM GOta. All right, I'm sorry. I hate lame tie-ins to ham radio and popular culture, and that is lame. But this show, which is really going to be another one of those Amateur Radio Parity Act shows, well, pretty good chance it's going to be kind of dry. So I needed some clickbait. Would somebody please play the clickbait horns? Thank you. Well, Cindy announced to me this morning that she is at level 4 playing Pokemon Go. Me, I'm not playing, which is going to make Jeff Buffington and Wilson Hines, two fans of the show, very happy because they're apparently all bent out of shape at this phenomenon. But you guys, Ingress. Remember Ingress? That very geeky go around town taking over things with your smartphone game that Jeff and I did a program where we thought it would be a great idea to put a ham radio component in Ingress, but it never happened. Well, Ingress is the guys that made Pokemon Go. Pokemon Go is Ingress, except it's really popular. So they figured out how to make money. Because, you know, not very many people did Ingress, but Pokemon Go, I'm just saying. Don't think there's any ham radio connection that we can make with Pokemon Go. Here's the real title of the show. Ham Radio Now, episode 259. Parity Amended. Yeah, I know. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Before we get started, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Arvin is sitting back over my shoulder, reminding you to stop by the website, hamradionow.tv. Click his icon, whatever the program is worth to you. PayPal is now working again. Yay, PayPal is working again. I also wanted to mention that the program is available as a podcast. I got the wrong thing on my screen. There we go. The program is available as a podcast. So if you're watching this on YouTube, maybe, you know, embedded on qrz.com or another website, even the hamradionow.tv website, it's all still YouTube. Maybe you have a hard time finding time to just stare at the screen and watch the whole thing. You know, I do long shows. But you really want to, you just can't find the time. I hear that a lot. Maybe the audio version would work better for you. I know I listen to a lot more shows on my phone, you know, here on the smartphone with a podcast app, because it's a lot more portable, so I can just drag them around. Even, you know, all the Twit stuff is video, but I listen to most of it on audio. So if you've got a podcast app or iTunes or something on your phone, you should be able to find us just by searching Ham Radio Now, all is one word. That theoretically works. It's worked on a couple of apps that I've tried. Separate words or just Ham Radio for some reason is not working. I'm not very good at search engine optimization. So you have to do it kind of right. If for some reason you can't find it and you decide this is a good thing that you want to do, well, stop by the Ham Radio Now website and click to enter. And then up here is this RSS button in the top menus. And so you click that, and it's going to explain how to get us into your podcast app manually, if that's what you've got to do. Okay, so on with the show. Here's the deal. Yesterday, or July 13th, 2016, because, you know, who knows, I may be talking to someone watching this show 100 years from now. Kind of hard to tell, sitting on YouTube. YouTube's still going to be around 100 years from now, right? Right. Yesterday, from my perspective, the United States House Energy and Commerce Committee passed an amended version of House Bill 1301, the Amateur Radio Parity Act. And if I can once again control my equipment, here's what that looked like.
Chair would first call up H.R. 1301 and ask the clerk to report.
H.R. 1301, to direct the Federal Communications Commission to extend to private land use restrictions its rule relating to reasonable accommodation of amateur service communications.
And without objection, the first reading of the bill is dispensed with. The bill will be open for amendment at any point. chair would recognize Mr. Walden.
Yeah, I think this is the part that's kind of dry.
I offer an amendment in the nature of a substitute.
I have an amendment in the nature of a substitute. Ask the desk.
And the clerk will report the title of the amendment.
Amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 1301 offered by Mr. Walden.
And without objection, the reading of the amendment is dispensed with. And gentleman is the staff will distribute the amendment. And the gentleman is recognized for 5 minutes in support of his amendment.
I thank the chairman. I want to thank Ms. Eshoo and her team, our team, Mr. Kinzinger's team. Everybody's worked together on this, and I'll talk more about that in the future. But we offer this as a joint amendment, a bipartisan effort here. There are about 730,000 amateur radio operators in the United States. I should know I'm actually one of them. The rest of you all pretend to be hams, but I'm actually a licensed one.
Yeah.
Amateur radio operators utilize
W7EQI. He's not getting his call sign.
Town, across the country, around the world, and even into outer space. Amateur radio operators also occupy an important role in the emergency response system. They are often able to establish communications during natural disasters when commercial networks are unavailable. Unfortunately,
so this is the usual blah, blah, blah that we hear.
Afford amateur radio operations the same level of freedom to operate that are enjoyed by consumers of other radio services. For example, the FCC's regulations ensure consumers access to direct broadcast satellite services. You can have a satellite dish. H.R. 1301 seeks to provide hams with the
certainty. You can have an ordinary TV antenna or FM broadcast antenna, too. It's not just satellite.
They will be able to enjoy access to communication service of their choice, regardless of where they live. This bill has come a long way since it was first introduced. Proud to say that thanks to the hard work of our staff and members of the amateur radio and community association communities, today H.R. 1301 enjoys broad support with this manager's amendment. This bipartisan amendment, in the nature of a substitute, represents months of meetings, hard work, compromise to ensure the amateurs are protected, but not at the expense of the rights of Americans living in deed-restricted communities. We found a good balance here. The amendment guarantees that even in deed-restricted communities, amateur radio operators are able to use an effective outdoor antenna. Without an effective antenna, amateur radio operators are severely limited. So this amendment ensures that amateurs are free to pursue their passion wherever they live. This amendment also respects, though, the rights of Americans, including amateur radio operators, who have chosen to live in deed-restricted communities. Millions of Americans live in communities like these and choose to set their own aesthetic and other rules. This is a knowing choice and must be respected. This amendment does just that. While it's rare to have the two groups with opposing viewpoints walk away from legislation happy, By golly, I think we've done it here.
By golly.
Both the Amateur Radio Relay League, that's the Association of Ham Radio Operators, and the Community Association Institute that represents
hey,
the
he got their name right, but he didn't get the ARRL name right. He's the ham. Greg,
this
come on.
Amendment. So again, I'd like to thank my staff, the staff of Mr. Kinzinger, the ranking member, Ms. Eshoo, the Amateur Radio Relay League, the Community Associations
Twice.
Institute, all for their hard work and expertise, which allows us to move forward with this legislation. The compromise memorialized in our amendment, the nature of substitute, represents the best of what our committee can do when we work together, bipartisan compromise that meets the needs of all parties involved. I thank my colleagues and urge you to support this amendment in the nature of a substitute, and I'd yield to my friend and colleague from California, if she would like to do it that way. Ms. Eshoo for comments on our joint amendment.
And she was the representative who had the
I'm
biggest problem
with
the bill.
On this bill, when we originally considered it in the subcommittee, I was worried that it would violate the rights of homeowners associations. And Chairman Walden assured me that he would work with me to address the concerns before the bill was marked up by the full committee, and he did. And so we found a balance that works for all of the stakeholders, and the bill is now supported by the Community Associations Institute and the Amateur Radio Relay League. So I guess when
she didn't get it right either.
Those groups as the
attention ARL, I think you may need to change your name.
It's been worked out. So I thank Mr. Walden. I thank Mr. Kinzinger, and I recommend to all of our colleagues, both sides of the aisle, that they support it. It's a good bill. It's a good worked out bill.
All right. And with that, I'd yield to the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Kinzinger.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to thank the ranking member. I want to thank you.
He was the original sponsor of the bill.
Everybody,
so it got started.
On this for the associations involved. This is a good amendment. Strikes the right balance, and just goes to show how legislating may take a little hard work, but we can always ultimately get there. So I thank you, and I yield back to you.
And in the nature of returning time to the committee to move forward on our other business, I yield back with 10 seconds left.
Gentleman yields back. Are there other members wishing to speak? Seeing none, the vote occurs on the amendment in the nature of a substitute. All those in favor say aye. Aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no. The opinion is here. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment in the nature of a substitute is agreed to. Are there further amendments to the bill?
No. No further amendments.
Seeing none, the question now occurs on favorably reporting H.R. 1301 as amended to the House. All those in favor shall signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed say no. The ayes appear to have it.
They appear to have it.
The ayes have it, and the bill is favorably reported.
Yay. So we did it. Don't celebrate too much yet. I mean, this is past this committee in the House. We'll talk about what's got to move on in the future for this to actually become a law. I'll get to that in just a minute. We got really lucky. Not that it passed. That was a fairly foregone conclusion, and I'll explain why in just a minute. We got lucky because we were the first thing on the agenda yesterday in a session that went late into the night, and then they picked it up again this morning. So we didn't have to wait around for our deal. And, you know, I'm really the only one that got really lucky because most of you weren't watching that. I was able to go to a local podcasters meeting, which I did instead of finishing this show. I enjoy going to these and meeting other folks that do this podcasting thing. And in fact, I have a studio guest, a live studio audience. Grab the mic there, Lawrence. Let me turn you on. Lawrence Hart is my guest, and met you for the first time at the podcasters meeting last night. Do you remember, after I introduced myself and told you what this show was, do you remember what you asked?
I asked if ham radio was still around.
We hear that a lot. And as you can see, it still is. There's right behind me is I can punch it up full screen, is a real ham radio. It's tuned to something. There was a guy calling CQ a little while ago. There's nobody there now. Let me tune a little bit.
Third owner. First owner was RF Concepts. Second owner was this RF something. Then the second owner was this RNC.
Yep.
And the third owner is this guy that's working with John.
Excellent Henry. Representative of the ham radio. So, Lawrence, you asked to come see the show. And I was guessing probably more for the technology, but you were mentioning before we got started that the technology is not your weak point. You're kind of interested in other stuff. What else do you want to learn from me?
Well, I'd like to learn how you prepare, like the topics you pick, the talking points. You're sharing things, as I noticed that you talked a lot about what they were doing during the session. So you prepare a lot. And I guess what a lot of people don't see is how much time you do to prepare for the show. And I'd like to know what you do.
Okay. So I wrote a script yesterday after I got back and recorded the session, of course, from Congress and edited a bit and to get things ready. So I'll show you. We'll talk about the rest of what it's all about after we get finished with this probably way too long a program. They're trying to call me again. That should stop. They'll leave a message. So it's not all the technology, all of this wonderful, magical technology that I've got all around me. You're impressed, right? I mean, you thought this was pretty cool.
Yeah, this is the most I've seen someone have set up. So yeah, it's a very amazing setup.
Yeah, and I was also going to guess that you're here less for the personality. And yeah, more the process, not so much personality. One of the other podcasters in the group last night, who has listened to my program some, not a ham, not anybody in the ham radio field. She does something else, but she does a podcast. But she said that she describes my personality, my way of doing the programs, as being a little bit of an ass. And she did. And I take that as a compliment. So, because kind of am. So that's the whole point. All right. So, and I'll prove it. Larry, shut up. You're done. Okay. I've turned off your mic. If there's something you want to interrupt on later, though, just wave and I'll catch my attention. I'll turn you back on. Okay. So, the Parity Act. Where was I? One step closer to becoming law. But there are other big steps that have to be taken before that happens. The bill has to pass the full House by the end of their session this year. And, you know, we got a presidential election and they've got recesses and there's a lot of legislation that's choking the both houses of Congress. So, you know, it's got to pass the full House. It also has to pass the Senate. The Senate has to amend the bill that they're working on so that it's identical to the one that the House passes. So, you know, what is this amendment thing all about? Well, we've talked about that before in Ham Radio Now, episode 245, all parody, all the time. Was I going to play some audio from this? I think maybe I was. Let me see. I don't remember. I didn't make a good enough note. So let me see if I've got this. I think I do.
Yes, I now recognize the gentlelady from California, Ms. Escher.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I want to thank Mr. Kinzinger for his legislation. This is a bipartisan bill. You've worked hard on it, and it shows, because there are over 100 co-sponsors. So while we have some concerns about, you know, the bill having impacts on homeowners associations, I appreciate Chairman Walden saying that that we'll work this out, as you said, and so we're prepared to move this along with a voice vote. So thank you for your work, and I yield back.
Gentlemen, yield.
Oops. Okay, so that was Representative Anna Eshoo. She's from California. When it was back last February 10th, that the House Communications and Technology Subcommittee, and that's the one that Greg Walden, W7EQI, you should give your call sign on when you're talking about ham radio, Greg, even before Congress. You should. We want you to. So they voted to approve H.R. 1301 back on February 10th in their subcommittee, the Communications and Technology Subcommittee. But there was that catch. They had received a submission from the Community Associations Institute, the CIA, CAI, not CIA. And they had some proposed amendments or some things that they didn't like very much. And they got Anna Eshoo's ear on that. So she was concerned about some of those things. So that's what she was talking about. And then they talked about making a compromise to amend the bill, but they weren't ready to do that amendment yet. But to keep things moving back in that session, they...
the question now occurs on forwarding H.R. 1301 to
They
the
decided to vote on it as
All
it was.
Those in favor say aye. Aye. Those opposed say nay. The ayes appear to have it. The ayes have it. And the bill is favorably reported.
Yep. So it went out of committee in its original language with the understanding that before it went to the full committee, it was going to be amended. So that is what the House Committee on Energy and Commerce, the parent committee of the Communications and Technology, that's what they voted on yesterday, the amended version. Let's see. Way last November, the Senate Commerce, Science, and Transportation Committee passed the bill in its original form. Two senators voted no, but that wasn't enough to stop it. And maybe you remember from Schoolhouse Rock, you know, I'm just a bill on Capitol Hill. The House and Senate have to pass identical bills before it goes to the president to be signed into law. And now the bills in the House and Senate are different. So something's got to give. The House version is the one with the compromise that everybody agrees with. I think that the two senators that were opposing it were looking for a compromise like that, so they'll probably be happy with it. So I think the push will be to align the Senate's version to the House's version, and I don't know how that was going to work technically. I don't know if it's got to go back to the Senate, to the committee, or if it can be amended before it goes to the full Senate, and that's its next stop, the full Senate. Time is short. We got that election coming up. Vacations to take. They all got to go back and try to get money out of you so they can get reelected. We'll see. We'll see how that's going to work. I have swapped some email with, these guys. ARRL's General Counsel Chris Imlay, W3KD. He's in the middle. And Mike Lysenko, N2YBB. He's our Hudson Division Director. And I'm hoping to have one or both of them on the show again next week so we can talk about how that compromise got reached and what is going to happen maybe next. And what we're looking at here is Ham Radio Now, episode 213. That was from about a year ago when they were talking about the bill being introduced into the Senate. Those are the guys that have done a lot of the legwork in getting legislators on board, mostly in the House, but also in the Senate. So I'm looking forward to getting their perspective and some education. Meanwhile, for the rest of this program, I am going to compare the original bill with the amended version. I'm going to read a lot of it because some of you are listening only to the audio and you can't see what I'm going to put up on the screen, but I'm going to put the two side by side on the screen for the television audience. And I'm going to see if I can point out the parts that are still causing some heartburn among some hams. I'm going to call those guys the battle bots on QRZ.com. They say that the amendment makes the bill worthless in their humble estimation. So let me see if I can get that stuff up on the screen. There we go. On the left, the original bill, H.R. 1301. On the right, in this corner, weighing in at a little heavier weight than 1301, is the amended version. The bill starts with some fairly routine blah, blah, blah. What they call their findings. There are more than 700,000 ham radio operators. We, at no cost to the taxpayers, provide a fertile ground for technical self-training. Yeah, blah, blah. The strong federal interest in the effective performance of our ham radio stations in our residences. And they talk about PRB1. So here are some things that I highlighted that I think are important to point out. This, again, is still from the original bill. And this is what the original bill was going to try to do. When I did the program with Chris and Mike, they talked about three legs that PRB1 stands on, sort of a three-tiered, a three-columned thing. And that is included here. Here's the things that an HOA, homeowners association, would not be able to do in the original version of the bill. Anything that precludes ham radio communications. In other words, can't say no. Anything that fails to reasonably accommodate such communications. So there's that reasonably word that a lot of people get hung up on. And finally, anything that does not constitute the minimum practicable restriction on ham radio communications to accomplish the legitimate purpose of any private entity seeking to enforce such restrictions. And if you're looking at the video and pretty much what I just read, everything that's highlighted here, that's the bill. There's nothing else. It stops there. Okay, so we'll go on to the amended version. And what it says is, it starts out by saying, strike all of the enacting clause and insert the following. So in other words, get rid of everything you just saw. It's all gone. And now here's the bill. The same group of findings that was in the other bill, although they upped our numbers from 700,000 to 730,000. And I highlighted this. It's still in the original bill. It's still from the original language, but I thought that this was interesting to see. Ham stations have been shown to be frequently and increasingly precluded by unreasonable private land use restrictions, including restrictive covenants. Now, remember, this is the compromise bill that the Community Associations Institute said they're on board with. And so they're on board with the language that says, yeah, you guys kind of got aced out by typical HOA rules and regulations. So that's still in there. And then all this stuff is still the same thing as what was in the original bill. Now, this is where it stopped. And as we start here on line 20, paragraph 6, this is all the new stuff. So I'll just read some of that new stuff. There are aesthetic and common property considerations that are uniquely applicable to private land use regulations and the community associations obligated to enforce covenants, conditions, and restrictions in deed-restricted communities. These considerations are dissimilar to those applied to state law and local ordinances regulated by the same residential amateur radio facilities. So, it's kind of legalese language, but it's basically saying that HR 1301 and PRB 1, the thing that applies to municipalities, government, state, things like that, are not the same. They have differences, and that is why the original language in 1301 needed to be amended. Because as we move this legislation into the homeowners association, into the realm of the community associations, there are some differences, some things to take in consideration of. And then the language we're going to follow up will explain all of that. In recognition of these considerations, a separate federal policy that exists in 9715B, Title 47, that's PRB 1, a separate policy is warranted concerning ham radio communications in deed-restricted areas. So here's the next paragraph for the new stuff. Community associations should fairly administer private land use regulations in the interest of their communities, while nevertheless permitting the installation and maintenance of effective outdoor and radio antennas. Let me read that line again, the second half of it. While nevertheless permitting the installation and maintenance of effective, and I've double underlined the word effective, outdoor, should not double underline outdoor as well, amateur radio antennas. So remember that, because as we come up to some of the objections, that is going to be a primary line in countering the objections that hams have in saying that this thing isn't worth the digits it's being rendered on my screen in. Okay, because this is what this next part is what some of them focus on. There exist antenna designs and installations that can be consistent with the aesthetics and physical characteristics of land and structures in community associations while accommodating communications in the amateur radio service. So, yes, that is vague. There exist these things. So hams are going to immediately think, well, we're going to have to bury our antennas underground. We have to do the stealth thing, you know, hiding them in flagpoles and sticking them under rain gutters, things like that. So we have two things in this one section that tend to combat each other. Installation and maintenance of effective outdoor amateur radio antennas. What's that? That's in the technical eye of the beholder. And there exist antennas and designs and installations that can be consistent with aesthetics and physical characteristics, et cetera, et cetera. What does all that mean? Well, I can't tell you. That is vague. It's deliberately vague. And what it ends up meaning is that this is something you will have to negotiate with your HOA when it's time to talk to them about putting in an antenna. Okay, let's look at the rest of this. This paragraph here, this is just sort of the enacting thing, 120 days after the enactment of the act. The FCC shall amend the ham radio rules by adding a new paragraph, that's new language, by adding a new paragraph that prohibits the application to amateur stations of any private land use restrictions, including restrictive covenants, that. And now here's the revisions to what was in the original part. And again, this is the three-tiered three-legged stool, the can't prohibit, must reasonably accommodate, and minimum practicable. And I pulled that out of memory. I'm impressed with myself. Okay, that has changed too. On its face, or as applied, precludes communications. I'm not a lawyer. I don't know how to interpret the difference in that. So, you know, once again, the original was just precludes communications, and the new one is on its face or as applied, precludes communications. That seems like something that's more in favor of the hams. You know, it's a more definitive statement that no matter how you slice it, if it keeps us from having a good ham station, they can't do it. Let's see what's next. Fails to permit a licensee in an amateur radio service to install or maintain an effective outdoor antenna on property under the exclusive use or the control of the licensee. And I put that last part highlighted in red. What they're talking about here is, because remember the original was fails to reasonably accommodate such communications. The new one is fails to permit a licensee to install or maintain an effective outdoor antenna, on property under the exclusive use or control of the licensee. And that second part, the property under your exclusive use, is going to come up again. And that's something that was important and is important to the homeowners associations and the CAI. And number three, which used to be a minimum practicable restriction, starts the same way. They can't do it if it they can't set rules that don't constitute the minimum practicable restriction on such communications to accomplish. And here's new language, the lawful purposes of the community association seeking to enforce such restrictions. What they've done there is they've added the words community association. The original language here said private entity seeking to enforce restrictions. So now it's community association seeking to enforce restrictions. And again, that is where the original bill ended, with those three pillars, must permit, minimum restrictions, and reasonable accommodation. So those are the three things. They're still in the new bill, the amended bill. They've just been modified a little bit. But now there's a whole bunch of new stuff. And this is something that this one is one of the things that is sticking in the craw of a lot of the hams who say it makes it useless. It requires any licensee to notify and obtain prior approval from the community associations concerning an installation of an outdoor antenna. Hams don't want to do that. They want to just put up their antennas and tell the homeowners association, I'm sorry, the rules say I can do this, and it doesn't matter what it is. Well, I think that was a bridge too far. No one was going to go for that. Congress or the homeowners associations and the CAI, that's something that we might want, but that is a compromise we have to make. So we have to obtain approval. Now, hams are saying that means they can say no. But remember, the other language here says they can't say no. And they have to approve a reasonable and effective outside antenna. They can't tell you, no, you can put up something in the attic. An outside antenna, reasonable and effective. Yes, those are weasel words. Yes, they're vague, but they're better than nothing. The community association must be able to prohibit the installation of any antenna or support on common property, not under the exclusive use or control of the licensee, which means if you're in a condo area, you have your property, and then there's a common area. Even in the neighborhood I live in, which is all single-family houses, there is some common, commonly owned property. Typically, the perimeter, the entrance, right next to my house is commonly owned property. Between my house and the street, so I can't insist on them allowing me to use anything out there for part of my antenna support. I can ask. They can give that permission, but they can say no. So I can put the stuff up where I have exclusive control of the property. and that is guaranteed. I can do that in some form or another, but I can't insist that I be able to use the flagpole or a fence post or even a tree that's sitting outside my property. Again, I can ask. They could say yes, or they could say no. Let's see what's next. This section talks about not being able to preclude an effective outdoor antenna, so subject to the standards specified in paragraphs 1 and 2. That is the paragraphs 1 and 2 are what says they can't preclude and must permit an effective outdoor antenna. So subject to that, the HOAs can permit the community association to establish reasonable written rules concerning the height, location, size, and aesthetic impact of and installation requirements for outdoor antennas and support structures for ham radio stations. So they can write some rules that say how things can be done. As long as those rules permit the reasonable, effective outdoor antenna. Yes, we need Solomon here to. No one wants real specific language about just what kind of antenna you can put up. Because you may have a 30-foot or 60-foot tower in mind and a beam on top, and they may have a barely visible dipole. Speaking of which, Larry, pick up your microphone again there. When I brought you into the house, I pointed to the antenna. Could you see it right off the bat? Oops. I got to turn on your mic. Sorry. Okay.
No, I didn't see it when I drove up. I didn't even see it when you pointed it out to me.
Okay. So it was a dipole. You know, it was not a 60-foot tower with a monster antenna. It was just a wire, but it was right over your head. Well, you say you didn't see it even after I showed it to you.
Yeah, you pointed out, and I had to follow it. First of all, it was a fairly large antenna. It must have been at least 100 feet across. And
it's 150 feet long, but it goes to half of it's behind the house, so you didn't see that. Okay. So, thank you. I'm not sure that proves anything, but it's an interesting observation from a disinterested party. Okay, so they can write some rules that decide from their perspective how things are going to be. Does that mean that you can't dispute those rules? Well, sure you can. And say, that doesn't sound like reasonable and effective and minimum practicable to me. And the thing that this lets you do that we weren't able to do before is get a seat at the table and make them sit at the other seat at the table and talk to you about it. They didn't have to do that before. Now they have to. Or if the bill passes, they have to. That's what this would do. The next section basically just says that whatever they do with this doesn't change PRB1. And then there's a bunch of definitions, you know, what a community association is, HOA, and other terms. All that's just pretty routine. So that is the amended bill. Yeah, sure. The terms effective and reasonable, deliberately vague. Reasonable has been part of PRB1 since the beginning, 1985. We don't have a lot of documentation to show how successfully implemented PRB1 has by hams who negotiated with their local zoning boards. Because if they were successful, you didn't really hear about it very much. You heard about the hams that were not successful. And we have a handful of court rulings when things went that far. Decisions have gone both ways in the courts, some for us and some against us. The most recent one that I'm familiar with is the case of Gary Wadke, WW8N, in Swanton, Ohio. His town, municipal, again, not HOA, municipal, said, can't put up your tower. And he showed them PRB1, and they said, can't put up your tower. And they went to court, and the court ruled in his favor, and the town said, can't put up your tower. So they escalated it to another level of court, and he won, and the town said, can't put up your tower. They eventually took that to, or at least the town wanted to escalate it to the Ohio Supreme Court. The Ohio Supreme Court said, nah, we're not going to take this. Back to the lower court. The lower court said, you can put up your tower, and this court ruling serves as your permit to do that. Town is not going to give you a permit. Here's your permit. Go put up your tower. Gary is happily operating off of his tower. cost him a fortune. So some hams worry that the vague language that we've got could result in a lot of court cases pitting hams against their homeowners associations. That is a worst case scenario. I'm sure there'll be some that come up, just as there have been some resulting in PRB1. I don't think anybody at the ARRL or the CAI, that's ARRL, Greg, sorry, or the CAI, I don't expect either one of those people at either organization expect a lot of court cases. I expect them to see negotiation and compromise. Remember, seat at the table that we didn't have before. So they can't say no. Remember, today all the marbles are in the HOA's bag. They can say no. The ham has no recourse. This bill doesn't tip the table in ham's favor. It balances it pretty well in my estimation. I never expected the original language to pass as written. I don't see anything here that I have a big problem with. So there are those hams on the other side of the argument. A usual side of the argument you might expect for hams, but there are hams that have taken the position that anyone who bought a home with HOA restrictions willingly entered into a contract and has to accept the rules and has no right to complain. You'll see a lot of those guys on QRZ.com. There's a lot of counterarguments. Restrictions are not a negotiated contract. It's take it or leave it. It's getting harder to find non-HOA housing, and there's a lot of factors besides ham antennas in a choice of home location. People have families, schools, jobs, commuting. We can't all live out in the boonies with 10 acres of space around us, so just go find someplace like that, is not a viable option for many hams. HOA areas are pretty much the only places that they can get a home that meets the other conditions that they want to live under with family, things like that. And that 10 acres out in the middle of no place, ask K9CT, Craig, one of the guys that was in, he's a big DXer, he's a big contester. He was in the Navassa video. He built a contest station out in Illinois, not too far from Peoria, but out in farm country, and he had a neighbor across the street saying, "Oh, it's ugly. He's putting up a bunch of towers and it's all ugly. It's ruining the landscape." And he was out in the middle of no place. So that doesn't guarantee that you're not going to have anybody complaining about what you do. My favorite argument about all this today is that, one other thing, hams, people become hams long after buying a house. So you're in your house, you've been there for years, and you become a ham. Wasn't a consideration when you agreed to those rules that you didn't have any choice about agreeing to. It was just take it or leave it. Okay, so my favorite argument, though, today is that seeking redress from an oppressive situation through the FCC rules or congressional legislation is a normal part of the political process. You don't have to roll over and take it. Or as one guy on QRZ.com is so fond of saying, in all capital letters, italicized, deal with it. You don't have to deal with it. You can do this. But you do have to get involved. The ARRL has been asking hams to contact their representatives. They've had form letters on their website. They have had them at ham fests. That didn't happen much immediately before this committee meeting that happened yesterday. I didn't see a big push to line up congressmen and women on the side of this bill. I'm not sure why, but I think it may be because the compromise that was reached, the amended bill, rendered it non-controversial. There wasn't going to be any opposition to it. I wasn't really sure if that would be the case before the session. I was thinking, maybe a representative could be spurred to oppose it anyway. You know, one of the deal with it hams got to him, but that didn't happen. So I'll have to ask Chris or Mike what the league wants members to do next, because in theory, this goes to the full House. The Senate bill gets amended, goes to the full Senate. Getting action on those, again, I'm thinking that it is not going to be controversial. So it's not going to be like there's a big fight. I think the thing that is going to be hard to do now is to just get it through the process and out the other side. We are a lot farther along in this process than I ever expected to be. And that is it for this show. Once again, Arvin, sitting behind me, says, go to hamradionow.tv. Click on his icon if you enjoy the program, whatever it's worth to you. You can join the Patreon for a monthly contribution, or use a credit card or PayPal for a single individual contribution. And a lot of people have been doing that, especially the PayPal thing now that it's back. Got a bunch of contributions there. So thank you, guys. You are, as always, awesome. And I am Gary Pierce. This guy sitting over here taking notes furiously. What do you think of... Go ahead and pick up the mic again. What'd you think? How did we do?
You did good. I learned a lot on the show. Thank you very much.
So have you... ever had hams in the neighborhood? Well, you were asking, is ham radio still around? So apparently not.
Well, my father was a ham operator I was a kid. So he used to talk to Germany and other places.
Yeah, he had and he had the ham antennas strung up all over the house.
He did.
Yes, did he have a tower?
When I was younger, he did, yes.
Yeah. Did the neighbors ever complain?
We were not in an urban area. Okay, kind of in a rural area.
Out in the middle of no place, which is what we would all like to be, but... You know, even though my wife is a licensed ham, this is where we're living, and this is a suburban development with an HOA. So, you know, this very much applies to me. Thank you for coming by, and being a part of the show. I am Gary Pierce. There I am. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, 73. Everybody, we'll see you next time. Over and out.